FCC, would you stand with us as we begin our worship this morning? Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows. You win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. And Almighty Fortress, you go before us. Nothing.
Came down, you turned my morning into dancing, give me beauty for ashes, beauty for ashes.
We're going to do a new song. It's called Gratitude. And the writer of the song talks about his humble offering of thanksgiving to an infinite God. Says this gentle ballad explores the tension between the overwhelming gratitude towards God and the corresponding awareness of the limitations of his own infinite humanity. And he says, during the chorus, it says, "So I throw up my hands and praise you again and again, because all I have is a hallelujah. I know it's not much, but I have nothing else fit for a king except for a heart singing hallelujah." I read a quote that says, "Gratitude is the memory of the heart." And maybe some of you came in this morning barely having a hallelujah, but you made it. So I pray that this song would speak to your heart. And remember Hebrews 12, it says, "Since we are receiving a kingdom that is unshakable, let us be thankful and please God by worshiping him with holy fear and awe."
All my words fall short, I've got nothing new. How could I express all my gratitude? I could sing these songs as I often do. But every song must end, and you never do. So I throw up my hands and praise you again and again. 'Cause all that I have is a hallelujah, hallelujah. And I know it's not much, but I'm nothing else fit for a king, except for a heart singing hallelujah. I've got one response. I've got just one move. With my arms stretched wide, I will worship you. So I throw up my hands and praise you again and again. 'Cause all that I have is a for a heart singing hallelujah, hallelujah.
So come on, my soul, but don't you get shy on me. Lift up your song, 'cause you got a lion inside of those lungs. Well, get up and praise the Lord. So come on, my soul, don't you get shy on me. Lift up your soul, 'cause you've got a lion inside of those bones. Get up and praise the Lord. Come on, my soul, don't you get
good morning, everyone, and welcome to FCC. My name is Holly Taylor, and here are your announcements today. This Wednesday, the Women's Ministry is starting a new study on the Book of Ruth. Make sure you get a book. You need one. On Monday, February 20th, the Student Ministries is taking all of the kids for ice skating and pizza. Meet here at the church at 10 a.m. and make sure they bring their $9. If you're like me, that's three kids out of my house. Woo-woo! Fourth, fifth, and sixth graders, don't forget, Superstar, February 24th and 25th. Parents and grandparents, more information is out in the lobby. Calling all women! February 26th. Women's Spa Night. Come here, 6 p.m. in the Fellowship Hall and get yourself pampered. Manis and Petties! Bride Beginnings 2023-2024 registration will begin March 1st. AB, see you there! The Volunteer Appreciation Banquet will be Sunday, March 19th. Save the date, mark it on your calendar. More details to come. Okay, so one thing that you guys probably don't know about me is this is my third year playing on the Decatur women's hockey team out of Decatur at the Civic Center. I got into this because I have three kids that play hockey and I kind of wanted a little bit more about the game, and it's also a great exercise. So thanks, guys. And those are your weekly announcements. I hope everyone has a great week and happy Valentine's Day.
Not everybody gets an applause for doing the announcements. So, if you have a Bible or something that you follow along with as we read from Scripture, tablet, phone, however it is, if you would get that out, we're going to be in a passage of Scripture today that's found in two Gospels. Matthew and Luke both record this event. You can turn to either Matthew 17, or I would recommend Luke chapter 9. Luke chapter 9. We're in our Core 52 series, and as we're going through this throughout the year, looking at these foundational core scriptures, putting them to memory, hiding them in our hearts, this week, our memory verse, the scripture that we're putting to heart talks about, if you've been following along, it was a prophetic word. It was a prophetic verse in the Old Testament where God told his people that he was sending a greater prophet. That there was a greater prophet yet to come. And you might go, well, why is that a core 52 verse for us this year? And today I hope to just help you make sense of that a little bit. In the fall of 2015, my head was spinning, literally. That spring, I had been here at that point for 3 years, back in Mweekwa on staff, and we were in a succession plan, which meant Lloyd was preparing me to move into the lead role, and the date that he had told me from the beginning we had been here was January of 2016. And yet in February of 2015, he said 3 months. In April, I'm out. And I was like, okay. And so here I was, fall of 2015, I was like 4 to 5 months into being a lead minister. And like I said, my head was kind of spinning. There was a lot of stuff going on, a lot of things in people's lives, and I was trying to navigate and figure out, like, how do you work ahead well? And how, like, you know, when I didn't have a sermon schedule ready. And so I'm kind of scrambling, and I'm looking at how to do this. And we were at a retreat for elders that fall, and Lloyd was like, "You need to come down and see me. Come down to Tennessee and see me. We need to talk." So I did. I took a week. The elders were like, "Go plan sermons, get ahead, come back with a plan for this next year." And so I went, and While I was there, I got a lot done, a lot of planning and a lot of work. And there was a day that Lloyd had texted me. He said, I want you to send me the location of where you're at. I'm going to come pick you up and we're gonna spend the day together. And so that's all I knew. He showed up that morning. He picked me up in his truck. Remember his blue Dakota? Picks me up in this blue Dakota and off we go. And I don't know where we're going. We're driving into the mountains, in the Smoky Mountains in Tennessee. And then he just parked, just randomly. And the whole time, it was like, I was having flashbacks to when I was a kid and my grandpa would pick, and I would just, there were days I would go with my grandpa, he was working, and I had no idea where we were going or what we were doing. I was just at his mercy, and I felt that again. I'm like, Lloyd, where are we going? What are we doing? I don't even know what we're doing. He parked the truck, we got out of the truck, and he proceeded to say, well, we're gonna go for a walk. We're gonna be walking up. And then he handed me his keys. And I was like, I've told versions of this before, so maybe you've heard it, but he hands me his keys, and a lot of things were going through my mind at that moment. He hands me his keys, and I said, why are you giving me the keys? And he said, because if I don't make it back, what do you mean if you don't make it back? He's like, well, I mean, this is going to be a little bit of a hike. And I'm thinking to myself, well, I don't know if I'm dressed, or I don't know if I have shoes for the hike where? And and then going through my mind is like, this guy, yeah, he's got 40 years on me, but he's in better shape than I am. And if he doesn't make it back, I'm not making it back. Why is he giving me his keys? So we started, I look as we're going up, and I see people that seem to be coming up the direction we are, but they're on this like paved path, and we're not. I'm like, that looks easier. What are we doing? And the whole time we're just talking. He said some things to me that shocked me as we were walking up there. He said some things to me that I think I needed to hear. We both got some frustrations out. I cried about the things we were talking about as we were walking up, and about how frustrated I was about things that were happening in people's lives and things that I had no control over and things that were just felt heavy on me. And we were walking up there, and then I could see this. Look at this picture. I could see this as we were getting up closer. It was kind of a little bit foggy, not quite this foggy, but I could see that. I'm like, what in the world? That looks like a spaceship on a stand. And so we get up there closer, and we get to the top, and the sun is fully up now. It was clear, and here's what I could see from up there. It was beautiful. And I didn't see it for a little bit, because like when we got up there, I was hunched over, like trying to, we're like talking, but like neither one of us can like speak in full sentences, because we're like sucking air big time, you know? And only later did I realize that we were at Clingman's Dome. It's the highest point in the state of Tennessee, even in the Smokies. It's the third highest mountain east of the Mississippi in the United States. We could see all over. In fact, they say on a nice clear day, you can see up to 100 miles in every direction. And it's a 360. I mean, you just turn around and it's all the way around. We're looking at this scripture today where Jesus takes three of his disciples. He takes three of the 12, Peter, James, and John, and they go on a hike. They were in northern Israel. I just want to give you some background before they're in northern Israel, in the area of, they've been ministering in this area, this region called Caesarea Philippi. And We're just on the heels, actually, to give you some context of what's been going on in their ministry. We're just on the heels of a conversation where Jesus said, "Who do people say I am?" And it's where Peter made the great confession, you know, "Well, you're the Christ, the Son of the living God." So if you look at Matthew 17 or Luke 9, in Matthew 17, verse 1 says this, "And after six days, Jesus took with him Peter and James and John, his brother, and led them up a high mountain by themselves." Now, in this vicinity where they were, like Mount Hermon would have been the highest mountain in all of Israel, and it was in the region where they were. It might be where they were going. We learn from Luke's account of this event that Jesus was praying when they got up the mountain. And in our minds, a lot of times when I've read this story, I don't know, as you've read this event in the New Testament and in either of these Gospels, as I read it, you know, one second as the word progresses, they're on the ground, and the next second they're on top of the mountain and they're praying, but there was a journey up there, right? We know there was a hike. They've walked, they've talked, maybe like you or I, or maybe they've stopped along the way when there were moments of like just picturesque view to just kind of take it in, maybe catch their breath and swig some water. Here's a picture from the top of Mount Hermon. What they would have seen maybe when they got up there. Do we have that picture? Yeah. Something similar to what the disciples might have seen here. But the special part of this trip was what Jesus had in mind when they got up there, right? Because what we know, when they got to the top of the mountain, Luke tells us in chapter 9 that Jesus was praying, and in verse 29 it says that Peter and the disciples were sleepy. See, they must have been sleeping. Here's the full text. I got it all on one slide from Luke. But if you zoom in there, as he was praying, the appearance of his face was altered, and his clothing became dazzling white. And behold, two men were talking with him, Moses and Elijah, who appeared in glory and spoke of his departure, which he was about to accomplish at Jerusalem. Now, Peter and those who were with him were heavy with sleep. But when they became fully awake, they saw his glory, and the two men stood with him. Look, Jesus had the keys, okay? Let's just tell it like it is. They get up there. The disciples are sucking air. They're wiped. Jesus has the keys, okay? Jesus has the keys. He didn't give them to any of them. And this is, they're falling asleep. They're sleeping. Jesus is praying. And as they start to wake up, and things are kind of foggy to them, they see this conversation. Now there are two men here. They're speaking with Jesus. And all of a sudden, Jesus is changed before their eyes. His face is altered. It's radiant. It's white. His clothes are dazzling white, it says. They are radiating light. I wonder what the other disciples were seeing at this moment from below the mountain. I wonder if they could look up and see, like, what in the world is that light up there? So it becomes clear to Peter, James, and John, though, that Jesus is speaking with Moses and Elijah. This is a wow moment. The Old Testament, there are several characters, as we've seen already with people like Adam and Abraham, but there are characters even to come that we're going to see in Scripture that are like, in Hebrews, these guys are, over and over, these men and women are referred to almost like a hall of faith. you know, like a hall of fame of these people of faith. And I'm talking about with Moses and Elijah, like these two guys are a big deal. Here, I'll give you this. I went back and looked, and here are the number of times that some of these main characters of the Old Testament are referred to in the New Testament. Adam gets referenced 9 times. Abraham, 67 times is talked about in the New Testament. Joseph, 10, David, 59, Elijah, 29, and Moses, the most, by a pretty good chunk, 80 times Moses is talked about in the New Testament. Of all of the characters in the Old Testament, as they're talked about in the New Testament, actually only 2 of them ever spoke with Jesus that we know of face to face. And this is it right here, Elijah and Moses. Moses, here in this conversation, Moses, to God's people, to the disciples, Moses would have represented the law. Moses would have represented the law. The first 5 books of the Old Testament, he delivered those. Many of what exists in law, he delivered from the mountain, from God to his people. The 10 commandments are part of that. It was the foundation for the Israelite people and for what God had to say to them. Elijah represented the prophets. Elijah was a great prophet. In fact, the last time before this moment with the disciples on the mountain, the last time anyone saw Elijah, you remember what happened? You know God's word well enough to know what happened. When it was time for Elijah to go to heaven, God just took Elijah from the earth. It was different, man. When that time came, there were actually people who didn't want Elijah to go. They wanted him to stay. One of those people, Elijah was so special. One of those people was Elisha, who was kind of being mentored by Elijah. He was learning from him and following him, and he was determined not to let him go. And so as we get this event of Elijah going to heaven, there's actually a chariot of fire that had to come and separate Elisha from Elijah so that he could be taken. And when he was taken up, it says in Scripture, he was taken up in a whirlwind. Even those who were there and saw it, they tried to find him. They thought, man, like, I don't know, you could try to explain it, like, I don't know if it would have been like a tornado comes along and just takes Elijah up, and they're going, oh my goodness, did you see that? Like, we got to find him. We got to find where this tornado threw him, and they looked for him. The best they could do was come back with his cloak. And no one has seen Elijah since. But now, these 3 guys get to see him. It was a big deal. Peter actually, it says in that scripture, in both, actually, Matthew and Luke, they both say Peter's just taking in how incredible this moment is as he's waking up to this and seeing this, and nobody's seen this guy, and he's Lord, this is a big deal that we're here for this. Can I build 3 shelters? God, can Jesus, can I build 3 shelters for you guys so we can stay? He probably doesn't even realize what he's saying. He's just overwhelmed emotionally. To be there, to see Elijah and Moses. Moses is the great deliverer, right? Here's the thing. There's been a lot of conversation. I debated on whether I was even going to talk about this today. Sarah kind of convinced me maybe it would be good if I did. There's been a lot of conversation the last... well, over years, but particularly because of the way some things have happened the last few weeks, there's this GOAT debate. Have you heard of the GOAT debate? Who's the greatest of all time? And it's come up because Tom Brady retired, right? Is Tom Brady the greatest of all time? And then, even worse, and this just almost makes me like sick to my stomach to say, is LeBron greater than Michael Jordan? Clearly, some of you have some strong feelings like I do. Absolutely not. Absolutely not. Right? Like, if you say that, I don't think you got to see Michael Jordan. I don't think you understand what he did. I'll just leave it at this. The GOAT makes free throws. If you can't make free throws and your team doesn't want the ball in your hands when it matters the most, you probably aren't the GOAT. Anyway, Moses is the GOAT. Okay? In this moment, on the mountain, Elijah's there, big deal. Moses, really big deal, okay? Moses is the GOAT, okay? He is the great deliverer. He's the one who had to take his sandals off because he stood on holy ground and he spoke with the Lord in a burning bush. He met the great I Am. Huge. He was sent to deliver God's people from Egypt. He was the one who raised his arm and the seas were parted. And he walked God's people through the parted Red Sea with a wall of sea on each side of him. Moses, he was there at the base of the mountain when God came to give them the Ten Commandments and the thunder shook everything. And this amazing thing was happening. He was there and he went up to meet with God. Moses, he's the one who brought them the law. He was there leading them on God's behalf for 40 years as they wandered to the promised land. He brought them manna. He brought water from a rock. I mean, tale after Moses, this guy who did all of these things, and just as they reached the promised land, no one saw Moses die either, right? If you know Moses' story and how it went down, God took Moses up to Mount Nebo. He showed him the promised land, even though he had told him, "You won't go." And God buried Moses. And nobody else was there. I wonder what that would have been like for Moses to die alone with God and be buried. And no one knew where Moses was buried. And now, here he is, and these three disciples get to meet him. Can you even imagine this moment? Can you even imagine meeting your hero? I can't. One of my brother's friend's parents. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, that's my closeness to meeting my hero. You know, because my hero is the GOAT, Michael Jordan. And I would say the closest I've been, my brother's friend's parents were on an elevator with him one time. Not great, huh? Like, not much of a story. And yet, to be on the top of this highest point in northern Israel, and to meet Moses. Better than a superhero who you've heard incredible stories of and who's literally the greatest of all time. And Peter was just so overwhelmed. He's just like, "Master, it's good that we're here. This is incredible. Can I build a shelter for each of you?" And then it becomes clear that he and the other disciples have just completely been missing the point. It says in the scripture that he was saying this, and as he was saying this, a cloud came over them. And it actually says that they entered into the cloud. They were enveloped in this cloud together. And there's a voice that speaks. And the voice said, "This is my son, my chosen one. Listen to him. This is my son." Right? Like, God's voice comes and God's just like, "Dude, Peter, enough with this shelter talk. Do you understand who you've been with the whole time? You're amazed that you're with Moses and Elijah right now. You're with my son. Don't you realize who's been leading you, who called you, who you've been following? Don't you realize who brought you up this mountain? This isn't about a man who was a good servant. This isn't about a man who spent some time in the presence of God like Moses did." If you remember Moses, there's almost a parallel there, even in the fact that Jesus on this mountain with Moses, with Elijah, with God, that Jesus is radiating, right? Because in the Old Testament, we see that when Moses would spend time with God on the mountain, his face would radiate light and he would come down. It was the glory of God. And people could tell Moses has been with God, but the glory would fade eventually, right? But this isn't like that. See, this is the Son of God. The glory doesn't fade with him. He's God in the flesh. And this radiant glory that you see nearly blinding you, Peter, is not merely a reflection of God's glory. It's the real thing. This is not another servant. This is not another prophet. This is not another hero of the Bible. This is God's only son, and he's been with you, and he chose you. And then Jesus tells them, "Hey, guys, you can't tell anybody. At least not until I've died and risen from the dead." Can you imagine seeing what they just saw? Hearing what they just heard? Experiencing what they just experienced and holding it all in? Moses may have given them the law, right? But Jesus is the one who institutes the new covenant of salvation. Moses may have given them manna in the wilderness, but Jesus is the bread of life, right? Moses may have brought water from a rock, but Jesus is the living water. Jesus is the only one who can lead people out of a life of sin. He's the only one who can deliver us from our wilderness of sin. In Luke, it says that as Jesus was speaking with Elijah and Moses, that they spoke of his departure that he was about to accomplish at Jerusalem, right? That word for departure, here's another great parallel between Jesus and Moses. That word for departure, Exodus. It's that word. They were speaking of his Exodus. And it was not leading God's people to some place on earth. No, it was him defeating sin. It was Jesus, that word Exodus. Jesus was departing and going ahead to lead us and accomplish what only he could accomplish, what only he could do. He was going to lead us out of slavery to sin. Sometimes I think we read God's word, particularly in the Old Testament, and I think we wonder, what is all this about? There's a greater prophet coming. And we go, okay. Why did all this happen? What could we possibly get out of all this? See, I think the more you read it, the more you understand it, the more you see that it's the foundation for what God's trying to tell us and teach us. Think about it. All of those years wondering when the people were upset and they're in the wilderness and they're looking for a promise, and even after they get to the promised land, right? And we read through the Old Testament and their relationship to God, and all along they're saying, "Where's God? Where's God? Where's he gone? Where?" And all along, he's trying to show them over and over that he was the one who was leading them. He was there. He was always with them and never left them. And yet, even when they got to the promised land, right, they said, "Well, look, what we want is a real king." Right? Like, we want a king that we can see. And now, the disciples are here on a mountain, and God says, "Moses and Elijah? Really? Have I got your attention now? This is the guy. This is my son. This is who it's all been about and who it's always going to be about." So as the praise team comes to prepare to lead us in a time of response, as we respond, I just want to ask you, and today, has he got your attention now? I mean, we go about our week and we go about our business and we go about our lives at times, and where's God? What's he doing? Why can't I? And man, I've been praying for revival, and I want God's kingdom to explode, and I've been praying for this or that, and I'm not sure what God's doing. And I think about it like this, it confuses people, but maybe today, and maybe in this context, this will make sense to you. We have our change ministry. It's the benevolent ministry of our church, and people give to it, and then we're able to help people in need with physical needs, with monetary needs, and other things. And man, it's just a hard ministry sometimes. And people come in, and as we're helping people, like, for a long time, I was just like, man, it just feels like we need to do this out of the goodness of our heart, and there's no strings attached, but there's like kind of a string. There's like kind of a thing, and there is a thing, and it's everything, right? Because like, yeah, we can help you pay that bill, or we can help with that need, or we can help feed your family, and we can do these things. But what I want you to know is, like, I want to build a relationship because I want you to know who I know. Because listen, church, he's died and risen now. And we know the answer to every problem. We know the goat. What are we doing? Father God, forgive me. You've been here all along. Forgive me for my failure to see Jesus for who he is and to rightfully surrender my life for so long. And God, forgive me for getting distracted and seeing other things and other people and other needs and not realizing that, man, there's one who has all the answers. You said it. This is my son. The Son of God. Listen to him. Father, give us eyes to see and ears to hear Jesus. Amen.
Standing on your faithfulness, on your faithfulness.
You're the God who fights for me, Lord of every victory. Hallelujah, hallelujah. You have torn apart the sea. Have led me through the deep. Hallelujah, hallelujah. You're the God who fights for me, Lord of every victory. Hallelujah, hallelujah. You have torn apart the sea.
Your communion cups. I'm going to pray for communion.
Father God,
we thank you. We thank you for the new covenant. We thank you for Jesus. We thank you for what he did for us on the cross and what that means in our lives. That just like Moses and just like so many other people in the Bible, God, that you will lead us. When our hearts are crushed, you are there. And when our hearts are full of joy, you are there, and you're the same God. And just the love that you show us, and the strength and the power in the name of Jesus.
to allow us to continue on, to allow us to fight the good fight, to give us the strength every day. Father, just the opportunity to worship together with believers on Sunday mornings is just such a privilege. But Father, may we worship you in everything that we do, waiting for that glory, waiting for heaven, but fighting for those around us to know you, to see our family again, all made possible because of your Son, and because of your plan, and because of your love. Help us to continue to fight. Father, if we don't know you, I just pray that you break down the walls and that you just help us to figure out how to walk with you in life and how to bring those around us to know you and to know the power and the love that you have. It's in your Son's name we pray. Amen. It's because of what Jesus did on the cross that together we're going to take communion. First, the bread, which represents his broken body. And then the juice, which represents his spilled blood for us. Amen.
Hey guys, we're here for another volunteer highlight video, which we haven't done in a while. And I just want to introduce a new volunteer that has been a part of our worship team for a while now, but you may not know him. So, Terry, first off, welcome. And would you tell us a little bit about yourself?
Okay. Obviously, name Terry Niles. Done worship for quite a few years. My wife, Debbie, and I have been going here for probably 6 months. And I am a worshiper at heart. I love worship. It all started way back at the age of 16. I was in a worship band called Seeds of Faith, and we played around Decatur.
Oh, cool.
And none of us knew what we were doing, but we had fun doing it. So just was hooked, and it's been that way ever since. Grew up in Catholic Church at a young age, probably around junior high. My parents left the Catholic Church and started going to different churches, and they found a church in Decatur. It was Raymond Christian Center at the time. And so I started tagging along, and that was pretty much it. So probably around the sixth grade, I would say, it was when I really started digging in, wanting to know who Jesus was. Debbie and I, we live in Stonington, and gone to Joy Assembly over there, guys, for years, and that's where I led worship, was over there. And it just felt like there was time for a change. So probably about 7 years ago, we ended up going to a church over into over at Springfield, and was over there for a few years. And we really just wanted something closer that we could be a little more involved with, that we could get to know more people locally. So we didn't even know the church was here, and we was scrolling, it came up on, I think, on Debbie's Facebook, and we said, hey, let's try it, and here we are. I think it's awesome when a church is a lot more hands-on with ministry, helping people. I've been very blessed with a knowledge of, you know, construction, and it's kind of what I've done throughout the years, and helping or just being that person to call, you know, when you need an extra hand.
I love those videos because it kind of breaks up the awkwardness. And so if you don't know Terry, now you do. And like he said, him and his wife have been coming here for 6 months. And if you haven't officially met, I know he'll be out here, and he would love for you to come up and introduce yourself as well. So if you would stand with us, I'm going to pray for our offering, and then we'll be dismissed. Heavenly Father, we once again, we thank you for the opportunity to come and worship you this morning. Father, may we be filled with the Spirit as we go out this week. Show us the opportunities that we have to witness. Father, right now, just be with the gift and the giver as we dismiss. It's in your Son's name we pray. Amen. FCC, have a great week. Thanks for joining us.
Wonderful God. You see, I see.